Thank you very much. First of all, thank you for coming this morning. And I just want to talk briefly about who we are and why we did what we did. And then Linda will go into the food safety aspect of what we try to do at our creamery. We are a seven-generation family of dairy farmers. We have always had Jersey cows in our family. Our family immigrated from Switzerland in the mid-1800s, and we've always been in southern Illinois dairy farming Jersey cows. We are located at Greenville, Illinois, which is about 45 minutes east of St. Louis, Missouri. And our farm is right off of Interstate 70, about 4 miles, which is very advantageous to us because part of our goal when developing the creamery was also tourism. So, like I said, myself, along with two of our daughters, own and operate the creamery. Amy and Beth, they are actually the principal owners in the creamery. We felt the next generation, if they were going to devote their lives to this, that they need to have responsibility for it. Both of our daughters, we have four daughters, but the two that came back to the farm have master's degrees from college, but they wanted to come back, so we felt at that time we needed to do something more. Our options were to milk a lot more cows or do something value-added. The value-added part was what we really wanted to concentrate on. So as we got into this, we first had to develop a marketing strategy. And part of what we wanted to do is we wanted to concentrate on our heritage and our tradition, but we are also a grass-based dairy, which is a little bit uncommon as what you see today. And so that was really part of our what we wanted to do. We also had the Jersey cow, which is a little unique. So that was part of our marketing strategy. By doing tourism, one of the things we felt was really critical was you had to have quality animal care because people are on your farm. They want you to take care of your cattle properly. As you can see, it all begins with animal care. We are grass-based. We do everything all natural. We are not organic, but we are all natural. And by doing that, we feel we end up with great cheeses. And as it turned out, a lot of our customers think so too. As our markets developed and we got into this, we found that our best markets were restaurants and chefs. Very, very loyal to your product, as opposed to maybe grocery stores try to pinch a penny here or there from you, will dump you if they can find a better product or another product that moves, as opposed to chefs, they're very loyal and very open to what you're trying to do and very supportive. There's a good food movement in the country today, local foods, and they are very, very supportive of what we are trying to do. As I see here, we have a sign of Marcoot Jersey Farm. You can see our cows cross the road basically four times a day. They go across the road to eat, to our pastures, to our paddocks. They go back and forth. And to me, it's a common occurrence, but when we do tours and stuff, you will see people stop what they're doing and run out to the road to watch the cows cross the road. So you never know what really people want to see as you go forward. When you do something like this, you have to find your niche. You have to know your market. You have to find your niche. When we built the creamery, we built it with viewing windows for tourism. We also built an underground cave, and it is modeled after some of the Swiss caves in Switzerland. It's 8 foot underground. It is basically an underground basement with a lid on it. We keep the temperature in there to age our cheeses at 58 degrees year-round with about 90% humidity. So it's a little bit different, it's a little unique, and it makes great cheeses. Very expensive when we first started putting it in, but our costs through the years are very, very low to keep this up, keep this going. As I said earlier, tourism is a big part of our business. We felt in our family history that we have always been very much about educating the communities and educating people and what we're trying to do. So tourism was very important. It's also another source of income as you get into this. This past year, we had approximately 35,000 people visit the farm. About a year and a half ago, the Girl Scouts of Western Missouri approached our daughters about doing some special tours if the Girl Scouts met their cookie sales quota. And we said, sure, why not? Figured to have a couple hundred girls come out. We had over 6,000 girls. So from the 1st of May to the 1st of October, we had a lot of young girls running around in green shirts out there, and it was a blast. So very educational, very informative, and we were more than proud to do this. So that's a little bit about us, why we did what we did. And as you get into this, the first thing you realize is food safety. You got to have quality food safety. And one of the things we had by doing this, we had some built-in advantages. When we built the facility, Linda's brother had just retired from Prairie Farms Co-op as an executive, so we had an inside track there with consultations on helping get our facility started. We also had my wife, Linda, who is a registered dietitian and had spent her whole life in food service safety and food management. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to her, and she's going to talk about what we did to improve our food safety as we developed our business.
Now, what I intend to do is we're going to go through, and I'm going to be telling you some things about the food safety program and how we set it up at our creamery. But I want you to know that the basics of what we're going to be talking about will apply to anything, any food product. So I'm going to be talking a little bit about FSMA, the new Food Safety Modernization Act that is being implemented at this time. And I hope that my goal is that I can make it so that it applies to whatever product you're producing. We know that when we're starting any kind of production, that we have a lot of things that we have to get sorted out. Our financing is very important. What we're going to produce, how we're going to produce that. Our staffing, you know, do we have money to hire help? Is the whole family going to, pitch in and get minimum to no pay for the first time as we're being established? What's our market? It's not going to work well if we produce something we have no market for. So all these things are very burdensome and can be very overcoming. We have a business plan that sort of puts all these things together. And now with FSMA, and when I say FSMA, I'm referring to the Food Safety Modernization Act. The acronym is FSMA, and what we call it is FSMA to make it short. That has now, with that new act, food safety is absolutely as important as any of the other things as we start a business. So, food safety and food defense become very important to what we're doing. Now, to begin with, I want to clarify what we're talking about. Food safety means the accidental contamination of food. That means somebody came in today and they handled a product, they didn't wash their hands well. That means that somebody didn't change their shoes, and as they were coming in, they walked through some bird droppings and carried Lord knows what in. Those things are accidental. But now we also realize that we have to be equally concerned with food defense, and that's the intentional adulteration of food. Something has been done to your food that was intentional. So now we're not just looking at what might happen. You know, we have to make sure that the sanitizers are working and that the personal hygiene is working. Now we have to be concerned with, equally as important, as what might intentionally happen to your food as it's being processed or taken to the market. So just to clarify on FSMA, as I said, that is the FDA Food Safety Modernization Act. And that what the aim of that whole act is, that to ensure that the U.S. food supply is safe by shifting our focus from responding to a foodborne outbreak and contamination to preventing it. So what we used to do is there would be an outbreak and we'd say, oh my goodness, let's go find out what it is. Now what we are doing as producers of whatever type of food it is, we have to assure that we prevent it before it happens. So that's where we're going to get in a little bit further in the talk. We're going to talk about what preventive programs we set up and how we do that, because now we have to verify that what we're doing works. We have to validate what we're doing works. So we'll get to that. Now, the implementation of FSMA is, it started in January 2016, was the first implementation. However, if you're a very small business, averaging less, this is according to the FDA website, a very small business averaging less than $1 million per year in both annual sales of human food and the market value of the human food that you're holding, you have 3 years to comply, except that starting January 2016, you have to have records on file to show, to prove that you're actually in this status, that you're actually $1 million or less. So that's the part you have to comply with right now. We have a little time here to get all these things, but we've got a lot of work to do, so it's going to take us time. If your business is subject to the pasteurized milk ordinance, you have 3 years, because they're going to be making changes to the pasteurized milk ordinance to concur with FSMA, and so that hasn't all been finalized yet. So we have 3 years if you are in that category. If you're a very small business with fewer than 500 full-time equivalent employees, you have 2 years, so January 2018. And all other businesses have 1 year. So in other words, what I'm saying is, if you go in the other business category, they started monitoring FSMA, but you have a year to actually get everything worked out. If you have a visit, they'll come and see what you're doing progressing towards it, but it will be more like a learning curve. And so that's what these time periods are. Okay, so what's that mean to us? It means that as producers of food for human consumption, we're responsible to develop specific and effective methods to keep foodborne illness from happening. Now realize, one of the big changes with FSMA is that this now moves into a criminal. It can be negligence. I'm producing this. I have no idea what I'm doing. I thought it was a really good idea. I didn't try to learn anything because I'm just going to plead ignorance. It's not going to work. And if you review cases that's been in the news, with the cantaloupe and different ones, people are serving prison time because they didn't find out, or they purposely, to cut costs, missed a step. Or there was a piece of equipment that they knew didn't work, they didn't get it fixed. Those are things that are very, very important now. I'm not trying to discourage everybody, don't quit producing your things, but I'm just trying to tell you that this is very important. This is worth taking time to learn about. Okay, So what are we going to do? Well, when I've figured out what I'm producing and some of those very first logistic things, I'm going to delegate a food safety defense coordinator. I need a point person to start learning what it is I need to do on defense. Just the same as I need a point person to keep my money in order. Now, we've got a small family operation, like my husband told you, and I'm going to tell you, we wear lots of hats. So it doesn't mean that a different name goes with each one of those hats, but you have to have a person that's dedicated. That is, you're all going to be busy, I realize that, but this has to be taken seriously. Make sure that you familiarize yourself with the FDA inspection guidelines. The FDA has a wonderful website with lots of information. I'm going to tell you it takes a long time to get through the layers of what all's there. And that's actually what we did with our grant is that if you go to our grant and on the front of your handout, we put that number on the first slide, and so that you could look it up. And what I've done there is I've got just numerous references that you can use with no charge that will help you get started on these things. The next thing you have to do is register your facility with the FDA as a food facility. And we'll talk about that a little bit more in a minute. And now what I'm ready to do is start looking at exactly what we're going to do, how we're going to do it, and we're going to start with standard operating procedures. That can also be referred to if you hear somebody say prerequisite programs. That includes that. Those are interchangeable. This also includes GMPs, GAPs, good manufacturing practices, good agricultural practices. So that all goes into the prerequisite or standard operating procedure part. So we're going to take these things apart and talk about each point just a little bit. And so we're going to delegate a food safety and defense coordinator. And I'm probably going to be at the same time thinking about in my business who makes sense to be on this food safety team. Because in most anything, there's a lot of things going on at the same time, and different people are going to need to have their eyes open and at least make some contributions. So seek information. Like I said, that FDA website and our SARS grant has a ton of references to use. Educate yourself with good, reliable information. Bad information, is bad information and it'd be very detrimental. You're spinning your wheels and you're probably going to be going backwards. So with the extension, with, like I said, the website, there are consultants out there, but beware that there's some consultants, it's like everything else, there's some good, there's some bad. So the bottom line is that you receive that education yourself. If you need to get it through another party, then that's perfectly fine. These type of conferences, the SARS website is phenomenal for information. Start getting yourself educated. Okay, the next thing is know what regulation you have to comply with. In our business, we have FSMA, we have the pasteurized milk ordinance, we have the 3A, that is the equipment part. So we have a lot of different things that we have to be aware of, and luckily, this is sort of a good thing that's happening with the FSMA is that they're all echoing the same main line. And so the same main goals are trickling from one to another with some uniqueness, of course. Study the regulation. I know it's going to put you to sleep and you're going to want to like want to smack somebody up against the head or something. Stay away from people while you're studying, perhaps. But study the regulation. Figure out what it means and put it into your business. And you're going to be the best person to do that. You and your staff, because you and your staff know what's going on in your business more than any FDA compliance officer or anybody else. Determine how the business will comply with that regulation. Okay, so the FDA food facilities registration. If you do a Google search for FDA food facility registration, it'll come up on the website. Now, if you need to use it, there is a company that'll come up first that will register your facility for a fee. To register yourself with the FDA, if you go to the FDA, look at FDA.gov, make sure that's in the website that you're clicking, and they give you a line-by-line guidance on how to do that. I'm not like disrespecting any company that wants to help you, but the thing is that you still need to answer the questions, and to pay extra money may not be in your best interest. Okay, so we've registered for online, and it will take first time through. It'll take you maybe, by the time we actually found what we had to do and, you know, got settled that we were answering their questions correctly, maybe an hour and a half. But it's not that daunting. Then you need to go in and re-register every October 1st through December 1st, anywhere in that period, on even number years. So you re-register. You will get, make sure whenever you do the initial registration, you print off, and it will tell you, it'll come up and it'll say print this and keep this information, because you have created yourself a PIN, so you can get back into that FDA food facility registration website, and that's how you re-register. You have a facility number now, and so now it's registered with the FDA, and they know what kind of manufacturing you do. Okay, so on to our standard operating procedures. And I'm going to tell you, this is going to be a work in progress. It will be a thing that you get settled, and then there will be a change in a piece of equipment. There will be a change in how you do some process, and you update your standard operating procedures or prerequisites to flow with that. This is like creating your own Bible for your facility. That's what you're doing with this. You're telling people how you're going to do it, when you're going to do it. Maybe you're going to put a part in there, why you're going to do it, who's going to do it, how you're going to do it. So that's what the standard operating procedures. And there's several things that I put on the SARS grant that gives you a template. So it gives you an idea of where to start. And make sure that you realize that the basic things are really important. Like, for instance, Ms. Orr said that making sure they had gloves as they were picking their product, they realized that's very important. And so those, don't just think that we're going to get the big, fabulous, really complicated things. Every step is very important that's addressed. So these procedures also include your GMPs and also basic environmental and operating conditions that support your food safety plan. In other words, what we're doing here when we establish these standard operating procedures is we're making a roadmap that we can refer to, our staff can refer to, regulatory compliance individuals can refer to, that's telling them how we do business here. Our standard operating procedures, consider this. This is the foundation of our whole food safety. If we build a good, firm foundation for
with our good, all-encompassing standard operating procedures, now the rest of our food safety plan is going to be very successful. So the contents of a food safety plan, notice there's two columns here. And we have a column which is to my right, your left, I guess, the required. So it has to have a hazard analysis. It has to have preventive controls. We have to address any of these that apply to our product. Our process, food allergens, sanitation. And then it can go on and on depending on what your facility is. Then we have to have some way that we set up that we're going to monitor. We have to have a corrective action because we all know that in real life, everything never flows the way it does. The way we say it, we wish it did. So we already decide that, well, in case this happens, then we're going to do this. And if this happens, we're going to do that. So we have some corrective action. Granted, there might be another thing that comes up that we haven't decided, but at least we've got a mindset so that in the moment that a catastrophe happens, we start putting ourselves in that mindset of things that we can do. Then we have verification. Okay, so I'm an old, a lot of my career has been spent in managing dietary departments. So for instance, just to make a simple thing, our thing that's very important is when we're manually washing dishes in our three-pot sink is that our sanitizer is at the right. Well, how am I going to know? That's what we call verification. How am I going to know my sanitizer in this three-pot sink is at the right? I have a test strip. So I stick the test strip in, I weigh the amount of time, I compare it to the chart. I have just made a verification. So what I'm trying to tell you, that verification can be as simple as a test strip, and I check it, and that's right. Now I know that if I use this amount of sanitizer and I use this amount of water, it's going to be good because I verified it. So it can be as simple as that. The next thing is that we have a recall and traceability. Now, a lot of people kind of get traceability and recall. They sort of flow from one to the other. Recall, setting up a recall plan, that means that I already have written down on paper. In the event that I get, for instance, a call from a customer complaint, and they say, I don't know, maybe, you're a place that you're making hot dogs. I'm making this up, obviously. And they just got a piece of hard plastic in their hot dog. Okay, at that time, my whole staff and I are just going to be, like, really maxed out, stressed to the max that I'm not thinking very well. I already have to have it written down who's going to do what. I have a person that's going to check the classifications of the recalls with the FDA website. There's three different classifications, four different classifications. One that is very seriously somebody's really going to get hurt or killed. Someone that, yes, very high potential they're going to be injured, but probably not. Third, that's not a good thing. I don't like looking at pieces of little plastic in my hot dog. And, so it's more like aesthetic. And four, it's just like, I wish it didn't happen kind of a thing. So there are different levels of classification. I have somebody in my recall plan. I already know, and they already know what it is that they should be looking at. Okay. Traceability is that I have tracked every ingredient I put in that product, and so I know when I take it, I know where everything came from, and when it leaves me, I know exactly where it goes, and so that's traceability. There's a few things here you can see that is useful. I want to caution you that if you put this in your food safety plan, that it is, you've now subject it to regulatory. Do not embellish, do not make things up that are not true. For instance, in your facility overview, make it very realistic. Okay, then we go on and we have our risk-based preventive control. So this is the new part of FSMA. And this focuses on what matters the most for food safety. It's preventive, it's not reactive. So we're doing things that are verifying. We do things now. I verify that that pot sink is at the right sanitizer, but now I need to validate it. And sometimes these words that we use all the time, but now they're in a different context, is very frustrating. But to validate, I need to know that what I've done is absolutely going to verify. So I'm going to, every time I'm going to test that test strip, but I might have a statement from the company saying that this is true. This test strip will tell you that. So I validate it. Like for instance, when we do our CIP in our creamery with all the pipes that run around, we have an acid wash. And so we have to do an acid validation. It's like environmental testing, swabbing. That's validating that what we're doing is right. Until we change the process somehow, it's validating. So that's sort of the difference. We work in conjunction and we're supported by other programs like our good manufacturing process, and we're designed to minimize the risk of food safety hazards. So that's what preventive controls are. Now, I want to just tell you a little bit about, how many are you familiar with HACCP? How many have ever heard of HACCP? Okay. Well, HACCP stands for Hazard Analysis Critical Control Point. And just a very brief background is that started back in the 60s when NASA was getting ready to send men in manned spaceships. And they didn't know for sure what was going to happen to the human body as it left the Earth's gravitational force or in space with no gravity or when it came back in. What they knew for sure was the food they sent could not make them sick. And so they contracted with the Pillsbury Company to do whatever you have to do to assure that the food does not make them sick. So that's where HACCP was born. They took every step of that preparation and they made sure that there was no introduction of contamination and that they did whatever they could possible to eliminate any contamination was there. So in other words, at that point in time, what we did was in product testing. We made it and then we tested it to see how it turned out. Now we're turning the tables and we're saying, nope, we're going to be proactive. We want to know what's going on as we do it. So very briefly, and if you're interested, we put our contact information on the back of your handout, but very briefly, this is what HACCP is. We do our hazard analysis. You look at your what you're doing, and you write down possible hazards. Now, I was working with one company, and they wrote down that, well, dust might fall from the ceiling. Well, that's a good aspect. It might fall from the ceiling. But what we're going to do is we're going to approach that in standard operating procedures. So I don't have to put it in my hazard analysis. I'm aware of it. And then we have critical control points. What am I going to do to make sure it doesn't happen? So if I'm cooking a hamburger, I know that I'm going to cook it till it's done. And my critical limit is I'm going to cook that beef to 155 degrees. I'm going to monitor it because I got a thermometer. I'm going to stick in it. And I'm going to know if it's not 155 degrees, I'm going to cook it longer, so that's my corrective action. The difference with preventive controls is that now we've added a step here that we say we may introduce that there may be allergen.
cross-contamination and those things. So this is the difference in preventive controls and HACCP. They work together. You still need a HACCP, but with preventive controls, you have more of a global. You don't necessarily stick the thermometer in it and cook it more to 155. It might be something like I rewash something again. So recall and traceability, and again, it's the ability to identify each product when before you got it and after it's left you. Then we have our consumer complaint program, and here we glean a lot of information. These are the main points on the consumer complaint program that we need to make sure that we include. There's a good, on the FDA website, there's a really good form that you can get and questions to ask. I would have that all printed up in my consumer complaint program ready to use because, again, you're going to get a consumer complaint right in the middle of you being really busy. Then we have our food defense training. And on the FDA website, we have our vulnerability and our mitigating strategies. And that's all looking at, it walks you through looking at your process and exactly questions to ask and how you can answer them. To evaluate your program, you could use third-party audits, feedback from inspections, but the most important thing is your self-evaluation. So in conclusion, developing a food safety and food defense program is essential. Maintaining an efficient and effective programming has to be ongoing. Food safety must be as actively pursued as any part of your business. And on the last page of your handout, I gave you our contact. And I'm really interested. I'm actually just very, very interested in food safety in a lot of aspects. And feel free to contact us if there's a question that you think we could ask. Do you have any questions?
It seems like there'd be a lot of documentation to this. Is there anything you would suggest as far as any kind of program or any kind of, where do you get an outline to keep all this together? Or is there anything you would suggest?
Okay, that's a very good question. How do you start? This is really overwhelming. There's a lot of parts to it. And that's what I put in our SARS grant. And I put, like I said, I put step by step, I use the FDA website because there's no sense to recreate wheels. Actually, you'll get yourself in trouble if you try to recreate too many wheels with this. But yes, there's absolutely forms that you need. As far as how the food safety, they don't care. Generally, they're in loose leaf notebooks. And you have a section that, you know, starts off with your standard operating procedures. And you have a section then with your hazard analysis because it kind of flows from one to the other. And then you have your preventive controls. And then that brings you can't do those unless you have a supply chain program where you're checking that the product that you're using in your product is safe. And so they all flow together. So I absolutely do. It's on our website. If you need more information, please contact me. I'll be glad. I mean, that's exactly what I love to do, those kind of things. So I'll be glad to help you with that.
And as Linda mentioned, all this information is also on the SARE website with her project report. So if you go to the first page of her handout, you can either search by her last name or by the project number, which is this FNC 13-918 on the front page. So if you go to the National SARE website, which is www.sare.org, click on the project reports tab, and then you can search for this information. She put together lists of all the different websites that you should go to and step-by-step how you should try and put this together.
Yeah, I think this is a very exciting time that in food safety. A long time ago, I went to a meeting, and it was on adding humor. This is not anything I can add humor to. I'm just sorry. But it was a very good program. This has stuck in my mind, and this has sort of been my mantra. In the on the side of the crowd, there was a woman that sat alone. And as the rest of us would laugh, because he was entertaining, she would not laugh. At the end, she raised her hand and she said, "I appreciate what you're doing. You're trying to make food safety interesting so people learn. I lost my 4-year-old son to a foodborne illness. Please don't let any other 4-year-olds die." And so I think that's what we have to keep in mind, that that's our business. If we're producing something, it's our business to make sure that every 4-year-old has a fifth birthday.